Across America, the pandemic has posed a unique challenge for educators and students alike, and it's leaving its mark, not only on their achievement in school, but on their peace of mind. Analysts believe the long-term effects of the pandemic could adversely impact a generation of students in myriad ways. Joining me today to help us understand how this prediction will shake out here at home is Santa Cruz County Superintendent of Schools, Faris Sabbah. Stay with us. Welcome, Dr. Sabbah. We are really interested in your perspective.
Thank you so much for having me, Becca. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, well, let's just get started right away. Of course, education is on everybody's mind these days, and there's lots of opinions and projections. And in doing my research for this interview, I learned that a national study by the Curriculum Associates shows that students are on a national level, not necessarily here, but 4 months behind in reading and 5 months behind in math by the end of last school year. And one group called this unfinished learning. What are your thoughts on the status of our students? Do you and your team feel that the last school year was unfinished?
Well, I think that as we transitioned to the distance learning kind of approach as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, we really had to do a rapid shift in the way we provided instruction to students. And I think that it was effective for some students and not very effective with others. Many students who were independent learners, who were comfortable in that kind of environment, I think did very well. We also had many families that didn't have internet connectivity, and we worked very hard to get them connected. But as a result of this, I think that we have seen some inequitable impacts to students as a result of the distance learning approach that we utilize and its impact on students also when it comes to their behavioral health, not only in academic progress. And so part of our effort now as we have brought students back over the last 6 months into the classroom is really to identify the areas where they may have gotten behind, help students connect with adults and others, you know, their friends and other support systems at the schools to really help them heal and recover and help them get back on track, both academically and when it comes to their well-being.
Mm-hmm. What kinds of things, can you describe the kinds of things you're doing to help them catch up? Are they programs or techniques or strategies?
So we've reestablished many of our after-school programs to support students with their academic challenges that they faced. I think that when it comes to social emotional well-being, we've been implementing multiple multi-level systems of support, that tier one social emotional learning type opportunities for students inside the classroom. Tier two, meaning interventions from a trained professional, like a therapist that is able to provide support. And then tier three supports, which are the ones when students are in distress and really need a lot of support to be able to deal with issues of anxiety, depression, and other serious behavioral health challenges. The idea of wrapping students with as much support as possible, I think, is really necessary. But the schools represent much more than just an educational system. They represent a wellness system. We provide food and support for families, information, communication. And so I think there was a disruption as a result of the pandemic that we are trying to undo and to reconnect with our families in a way that we weren't able to during the distance learning phase of the pandemic.
Now, as you mentioned that it is sometimes it's difficult for kids to learn kind of offsite and without their friends around them, and they mm-hmm. they miss out on some special things. And if they move to the next grade unprepared, they might be missing some keys that they maybe need to be successful. But on the other hand, students who repeat a year of school are less likely to complete high school. So has this That's been right. your experience? And what would you advise a parent thinking, oh, my child, you know, didn't get enough from the last year, he's a little behind, should I keep him back or send him forward, maybe not quite prepared?
Yeah, most of the research shows that repeating a grade is really not in the best interest of students. The idea that, well, they'll get more time to relearn the grade level standards, it makes sense, I think, and maybe from a logical point of view, but our experience is that students who repeat a grade are half as likely to graduate from high school as the students who don't repeat a grade. And so what we need to do is implement these acceleration plans. The idea is we're going to continue with you moving forward, and we are going to identify any of the areas that we find gaps in. And I have two kids, and I could see, like, in their math, there's certain gaps that of things that they didn't learn as well. And so their teachers work with them to help identify those gaps and then provide them with additional support, additional activities to be able to make up for those. It's difficult to do. And what teachers do during the classroom, as well as what they do in after school support programs, those different programs are able to provide some help with that. But I think it's really important for us to be aware that the students are having those challenges, and that this has been such an unusual time that we need to really spend additional time connecting with our students, supporting our students as much as we can, getting them whatever resources are available. And the schools have received a lot of additional funding as a result of the COVID pandemic. And so there's a lot of resources that have been put into the schools right now for social emotional support, as well as academic support and learning loss, as well as things that we can do, mitigation systems we can do for COVID-19. So I think there's lots of opportunities for students to receive additional support right now.
Okay. And is it too early to say how well that's going, if the support is helpful or successful, or is it just too soon to know?
I think it's hard to know when it comes to learning loss and when it comes to students' academic progress at this point. We are seeing a lot of behaviors from students that tell us that they've been having a very tough time. This is one way that they express themselves. We are seeing students that are having trouble engaging, and in some cases low attendance rates. And so I think there are behaviors that tell us that we have a lot of work to do, and that we really need to reconnect, re-engage with our students and their families, and to try to make up for some of the time where there was that disruption.
Mm-hmm. The United Way, I read that the United Way is partnering with school systems to establish a trauma-informed school initiative. Mm-hmm. And they're offering teachers training and resources. It sounds like you have something like that for our teachers. Can you talk a little bit about what it is?
Well, we totally, absolutely support trauma-informed practices, and we think it's a wonderful effort by United Way in collaboration with the school districts. And so understanding what that level one is that what all students receive. So if every teacher gets this training, that means every student is in a classroom with a teacher that has that experience. And so they know what the signs are. They know how to connect. They know how to not shut down the behaviors or expressions of students, and they know how to connect students to somebody that can help them for additional support. And so having that trauma-informed experience is really good. We have something that we've been developing, which is a social-emotional learning initiative, again, to help train teachers. We have groups of teachers that are working together also to develop skills to be able to create, classrooms that are safe and welcoming and supportive in a way that would help students, again, feel that they are engaged and connected and safe. And also, we're all partnering together with increasing the numbers of people, counselors and social emotional therapists, for the students who are in that second tier, the students who are experiencing anxiety and depression and who really need additional support. And so these efforts really are complementary. We want to increase the capacity of all staff members in our school campuses to be able to be sensitive and knowledgeable, to be able to provide additional support for our students, and also know how to connect students to higher levels of support.
So it sounds like clearly the mental health of students is showing up front and center here. And that is the case nationally as well. And one of the ways that teachers are seeing it on the national level, and probably here as well, I'm wondering, is with really high levels of chronic absenteeism. And it seems nationally there's been a 12% increase among kids from 8th to 12th grade. And 42% of students who are new to chronic absenteeism, who weren't doing that before school, are not going to school at all. And they estimate that 617,000 to 1.2 million 8th through 12th graders could drop out of school. Do you see this reflected in our schools?
Yeah, we are seeing a trend of absenteeism in our schools. Absolutely. Our enrollment levels are lower than what we had projected, and our attendance rates are lower than we had projected. This is of great concern for us because for many of those students who may feel disconnected or disengaged from school, the sooner we can get them back engaged and back in school, the more likely we are to be able to help them continue their educational progress. So it's definitely something of great concern for us, and we are seeing that trend here. So attendance is one of those areas that we pay attention to carefully. It also could have long-term impacts on funding, which could in turn mean we have less resources in the future for students. And so it's definitely, there is a lot of reasons why we want to be able to bring our students back. And wellness, I think, as you mentioned earlier, really has gotten to the point now as it's at the top level, just like academic achievement. We see our schools focusing on wellness at the same level, with the same level of priority as we do with academic achievement. And I think that's how it should be. I think our schools represent more than educational institutions. They are a place for support, a place for where people should feel safe, and people should be able to get all of the different services that are available to them in the community. And so we think that getting students back to school, whether they're working in the fields, whether they are hanging around with the wrong crowd, we need to bring them back into our schools so that we're able to support them. And that's that, because that's where they belong.
What do you think is the reason they are not in school? Do you think it is about the virus, or they're just out of the habit now, or it is hard to get to school? What could the reason be for staying home?
I think for many of them, many of the students had to, for financial reasons, had to begin working to help their families out because there was a loss of funding for the family. And so we are finding students who are working in the fields instead of going to school. And so we've been reaching out to try to get them back into school as a result. I think that for some maybe who felt like school wasn't a place that they wanted to be, they're seeing this as a way for them to disengage and hope that nobody, comes looking for them and requires them to get back into school. I think there's a variety of different reasons for that. But generally speaking, though, I think that once students are back in a supportive environment, they really welcome it and they want it. And so it may be not always the school that they were at. In many cases, we have students who come to our comprehensive high schools, and they end up possibly coming to an alternative school. We have such a great variety of programs here in Santa Cruz County. There absolutely is a place for every student, and we want to make those. We want to let them know that we're waiting for them, and that we're gonna. We hope that they'll come back, and we'll go looking for them, hoping to bring them back to our schools, because we can't allow this pandemic to take that away from them.
No, and are you trying anything? There's a program, and I want to say it's in Florida, but I don't quote me on that. They call it the ice cream and broccoli approach, where they are partnering with outside organizations to do things like math and sailing, and they mix up fun things with more serious academics. Is that an option, or do you already have that, or are you more interested in finding something tailored to each child?
Well, I think that we've been increasing, all the school districts have been increasing career and technical education programs. And so we have a lot of exciting programs, whether it's computers, whether it's construction trades, it's, biotechnology, just a variety of different options that the districts are offering students. And so I think that's really important, because if you can tap into the passion of a young person, and it's something they'll do the other classes just so that they can continue doing that one thing that they love. Sports is one of those things. Extracurricular activities is also a great motivator. And so that is one of the reasons why we offer such a variety of options for students at schools, is really to give them something that they love. My son, for example, just joined an environmental leadership club, and he loves it. And it's something that he's very motivated for and looks forward to. And I think being able to find something that they can tap into and really get excited about is also something that we want our schools to offer our students. And so it does mean finding out what they love, and also career and technical education. having a skill set that they can build on, something that they can focus on, whether it's they are thinking of being a firefighter and being able to take courses that could help lead to that, or whether they want to become a mechanical engineer and they're interested in taking some courses that's going to lead up to that. Those options should be available at schools, and getting them into that, I think, is part of what we're hoping for.
Do you find, or do you imagine, that sometimes the holdup is not the student, but the parent, that parents are concerned about sending their children back to schools for fear it may not be safe?
We have had a little bit of that. We haven't had very much of that. I think parents were really eager for their kids to get back to school. And so at first, I think there was some trepidation when we first started opening our schools back up for in-person learning. But with all the mitigation systems that we have, testing and masking and now vaccination available for all our students, we feel really confident that we've done as good a job as we could to reduce the risks for our students. And so we don't hear from parents saying, I'm not ready to send my child to schools because I don't think they'll be safe because of COVID. And so that hasn't been really something that we've been really promoting a lot of the things that we have put in place to make sure parents know about the different opportunities that they have, and that we will communicate with them if there is an exposure. We'll make sure that those options are, the testing and vaccination options are available to them. And that has been working really well. We've built a very robust testing system. We launched a vaccination effort for 12 and older. And yesterday we launched our 5 to 11-year-old vaccination effort across the county. And so we're hoping that we're gonna continue to be successful in offering options for students to keep them safe and keep our school community safe from COVID-19.
Once more students are vaccinated, will there be a relaxation of any of the rules that keep kids safe at school now? Will they be able to take off masks more often or anything like that?
Well, I hope that at some point we're going to be able to take off these these rules. We follow the California Department of Public Health, and so they're the ones that set this policies when it comes to masking indoors and requiring the isolation and that's all based on CDC guidance. But it's really we're required to implement those guidelines, and so that we are required by law to implement the guidelines. And so we're hoping that as we continue to make progress with COVID-19, that we're going to be able to see some of these restrictions reduced, because we all want to get to a place where it a little closer to what it was before. But until then, we have to remain vigilant, because we keep seeing ups and downs. Neighboring counties just reimposed their indoor masking requirements after they had taken them off. And so we're aware that this is an ongoing challenge, and that we have to be vigilant and continue to do the hard work of minimizing risks for transmission. And that's why we're working so hard to make sure that our schools are safe.
Mm-hmm. Kids are pretty resilient, and they I think they're doing a really good job of doing all these extra things while they're trying to learn new things. It's really it's kind of amazing that they march on.
I agree. I think resilience is the perfect word for our students and our staff and school systems in general. I think that the whole school community has really come together when we talk to parents, when we talk to all different folks who work in the school system, how we've all adapted to this new environment. And our students have been through so much, and they're working hard, doing their best to be successful in our schools. And so it's been wonderful being a part of that and to support that. And we're hoping that we'll continue to see the fruits of all that hard work.
And one of the things the pandemic, just one of the other things the pandemic made worse was, and put a big spotlight on, was some of the inequities in education in the United States. And one of the most glaring is access to the internet and devices needed to use it. How big a problem was that in Santa Cruz County, and how was it, if it was a problem, how was it addressed?
So when we first started the pandemic in May of 2019, when things, or actually it was March of 2020, when we first started the kind of looking at the possibility of closing down our schools to transition to distance learning, we felt like about 80% of our students had internet access. That meant that one in five students didn't have internet connectivity. And so the schools mobilized significant resources to be able to get internet connectivity to families. That included connecting with internet service providers, but mostly it was hotspots that we were able to provide students, so that by the time that by the time the summer and then the fall of last year, we had reduced that number of people that didn't have internet connectivity from about 20% down to 8%, and so 8% of students still didn't have internet connectivity. We continued working on that, and I think it's down to about 1% of our students not having internet connectivity. Now, the good news is people were able to connect. The bad news is that internet connectivity with hotspots is not a long-term solution. It's a slow connection. It's not great for video. It's not great for a lot of bandwidth. And so we believe wholeheartedly that our goal for our county is to get 100% of our students with significant bandwidth to be able to, broadband levels of speed, to be able to engage effectively with all the content that is available to them. And we think that internet connectivity is not just about learning as a learning tool to connect students to their learning environment. Because even today, our kids are still going to school full time, but a lot of what they're doing is online, and a lot of their activities, whether it's homework or other kinds of content, is happening through their device. But it's also a lifeline for parents. Finding out where Second Harvest Food Bank locations are available, finding out where vaccination clinics are available. These are important pieces of information, and it represents the easiest way for families to get connected. And so this absolutely necessary tool has to be made available to all parents and families and our students, and it needs to be at broadband speeds. And that's something we're committed to do. We're working with the Santa Cruz Community Foundation, with Cruz.io, with the Pajaro Valley Unified School District, Santa Cruz City Schools, and other school districts, to be able to increase the numbers of families that we are able to get broadband level speeds. And there's some funding that we're getting from the state government that will allow us to do this.
Wow. So is your goal then to make sure that all families have broadband for the length of the time their children are in school?
And beyond, I think. Hopefully the broadband won't go away, but some of the funding that we're getting from the state is not funding that is long-term. And so whatever we're hoping on putting in place, we're hoping to make sure that will last, there's a sustainability component to it. Mm-hmm. And that we're hoping that those resources will be available for their kids and their siblings and the family.
Oh, that would be a huge improvement. Teachers connect with parents via the internet about their students and what they're doing and how they're doing in school and things like that.
Absolutely. And it's important to note that this problem and many of the challenges that we got were impacted low-income families a lot more than families that were well-to-do. And so the equity aspect of how COVID-19 has impacted as families has a lot to do with geography and income levels and a person's ethnicity. So that's another part of the work that we have to do, is making sure that we're supporting the communities most impacted by COVID-19.
Now, another challenge that arose kind of related to that was access to food. And approximately 47% of students in Santa Cruz County qualify for the school lunch program. In the beginning of the pandemic, of course, schools were closed, but students still receive meals. Please talk about the role that schools play in Santa Cruz County in alleviating food insecurity.
So I think it was another example of how schools really adapted and were able to provide these essential resources. Millions of meals were provided to students through the school system. So when you look at the Pajaro Valley Unified School District Food Services Department, Santa Cruz City Schools, they work together with all of the school districts to be sure to offer meals to students, to families that needed it, whether they qualified for free and reduced lunch or not. And as a result of that, and of course, also with partnerships with Second Harvest Food Bank, students were able to get a week's worth of meals in one visit to the schools, and to be able to receive healthy meals that they were able to participate with and get. And so it's really a tribute to the amazing hard work. The folks that were there on site were our food services workers, doing an amazing job providing food to our families, served up by administrators and other support staff that were there to provide that. So really amazing work, heroic work in my mind, on behalf of our schools in support of our families.
So let's talk a little bit about the budget and California's $6.6 billion school reopening plan. How have you been able to, or have you been able to utilize that to help open our schools?
So a great deal of the funding has been focused on the needs of students, specifically in the behavioral health area. So that's been a key important part. Some of the funding was utilized to make modifications such as air conditioning and other kinds of structural changes to the schools to make it safer for COVID-19. Additional resources for schools, things like PPE for COVID-19, equipment to be able thermometers, things like that. The funding is also being used for training for staff, providing additional counselors and of course we are struggling with a teacher shortage and a staff shortage across our county, and so the funding is being used to be able to bring in a lot of these additional resources, both structural and people resources, to be able to help students. And I think that one of the concerns that we have, of course, is that we are going to be, the funding is going to run out in a couple of years. And so what's going to happen after the funding runs out? So we're looking at sustainability as an option, but we have to continue to think about all of the different things we can do to ensure we have created the right environment for our kids and the right supports for our kids.
We are out of time. I want to give you one more a quick opportunity to talk about the need for teachers and how you would like to fill that need.
Well, we have a short-term need and a long-term need. A lot of people were leaving education prior to COVID-19, and not as many people were taking those spots. And so we have a great deal of need, not only of teachers, but other support staff, drivers for the buses. We need support, a variety of administrators. There's a lot of positions that are needed in education, school psychologists. And so we need substitutes to help us through the times right now. And in long term, we have to create this career path for people who are excited about education. It really is the most noble profession, and I am a little bit biased, but it is amazing work. You get to connect with students, you get to inspire students, and you get to help change their trajectory maybe to one of success and achievement and happiness. And so we want to encourage people to consider getting into education as a career path. And we are looking at creating, partnering with the universities and other agencies to be able to create those opportunities for people to get into education.
Dr. Faris Sabbah, thank you so much for joining us today. And thanks to you watching at home. Good night.